Welcome to Read Between the Lines, a book podcast. I am your host, Molly Southgate, and today I'm interviewing...
Hi, I'm Hilde.
Hi. So can you tell me about your book?
Yeah, so my book is a memoir that I published, and it focuses on my growing up and being a reporter from the time I was 7 years old and some of the lessons that I learned along the way.
Yeah, and as I was saying to you before we started recording, I have been reading this book the last few days. It is so excellent. You've done so much as a reporter. Can you tell me a bit about how you got started and what inspired you to write this book about it?
So I got started in journalism because my dad was a reporter, and he was a reporter in New York City, but we moved to Pennsylvania and he'd quit his job. And it made me realize how much I loved reporting because I really missed it because he would take me along on stories. Mm-hmm. So I started my own newspaper. And the reason I wanted to write this book is because I think I learned some valuable things in my time being a reporter since I did it for 5 years. And I think I learned a lot of lessons on how the way people perceive you, how everyone's perceptions of you can really change the way you perceive yourself if you aren't really careful or really firm in your own self.
For sure. Yeah. With this writing process, since it is a memoir, you're going back through so many of your stories from your life. So what was that like revisiting things? And were there any things that were particularly fun or more difficult?
Yeah, I found it to be kind of almost a healing experience to revisit a lot of these things because a lot of these stories, for example, at the time when I was reporting on them, I really just didn't soak it in, if that makes sense. I think when I was reporting, I had a very, I had a lot of boundaries where it's like, oh, I'm not emotional. I'm not this person. I wouldn't let it get in the way of my work. So I think I really just didn't take in a lot of the stories I was doing. Mm-hmm. And as I went back to do it, I realized how much it did affect me that I just didn't realize.
That is really cool. Yeah.
Thank you.
As a reporter and as just a writer in general, over all these years that you've been doing it, how do you feel like you've grown?
Well, one thing is I was really shy before I started my newspaper. And I mean, I still am in certain ways now, but with my newspaper, it was basically at first an excuse for me to talk to all these people who I really wanted to talk to anyway, but I didn't really have the courage to. And I got to talk to all of these amazing people and hear people's stories. And I think it made me grow out of my shell a lot. And now I can talk to people without an excuse, and a story, which is nice.
That's awesome. Yeah. Now, for our audience, can you share a little bit about this newspaper that you're mentioning? Because I know about it, but I would like for people to have a little bit more context.
Yeah, of course. So the newspaper I'm talking about is called the Orange Street News. And I started it when I was 7 years old, I think a month before my 8th birthday. Yeah, because my first issue was in November. So yeah, I started it when I was 7 years old. And it quickly grew because I got a lot of sources because the other newspaper in my town was more affiliated with the town, the townspeople. And it covered a lot of towns while I kind of focused in on Selinsgrove, which was the town I was reporting on. Mm-hmm. So I grew a lot of sources and I started reporting on some pretty serious stories.
Yeah, that's awesome. Since you were so young and I still can hardly wrap my head around it, but I understand because I was the same way at that age. But what was it like for you starting such a big project so young? Honestly, still at this age, writing a book, most people our age don't have books out.
It's definitely an experience, but for me, I don't know how to really explain it, but since I've been doing it since I was so young, it's kind of, I don't really have an alternative to compare it to. It's kind of just been my life. Even before, I was always that kid who's, people, the adults are telling you that you're mentally 40, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
It's that whole thing. You know, I was reading all these books, but I wasn't really I wasn't that much like that. I still have a lot of, you probably can see them in the background. Obsessive amount of stuffed animals. I remember I got so many comments when I first started my newspaper. It was like, she should be having tea parties and playing with Barbie. I was having tea parties and I was playing with Barbies until probably older than I should have been.
Nah, never too old, right?
never too old. I still did a lot of the normal kid things. So I don't have an alternative to compare it to. That was just kind of my life.
Yeah, I absolutely get that. I've also always been told that I'm mentally 40, and it can be strange hearing that and being like, well, I am a kid. I act like a kid, but just not in every way. Mm-hmm. So do you have a favorite memoir or biography of any kind that you've read?
Okay. I'm so glad you asked this question, because I read this book in January because I watched the movie first, which I usually don't do, but I didn't even know it was based on a true story. Girl Interrupted. Actually, I think I have it around here. It's the memoir is absolutely amazing. It's so good. It's probably one of my favorite books ever, not even just for memoirs. It's amazing. I loved it.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. I've seen that one before. I've never I completely read recommend. The book, but it looks so interesting. Do you feel like any parts of that like helped influence your writing of this book, or have there been any sorts of books that have?
I don't know. I think probably not. I mean, not specific book, because I read that book in like January. So I just don't know the writing of it, of my book. But in general, I think I did a lot of, it's going to sound kind of, I did a lot of short story writing. So I think through that, I kind of got, even though the content was obviously so different than the memoir, I think I got a lot of my voice from that, because the voice you use when you're doing journalism is so different than when you're writing a fictional book or a memoir. Mm-hmm. So I think with my short story writing, I kind of had some practice like getting the voice down that you use. I hope that makes sense.
Oh, no, absolutely. Would you mind sharing, like, do you have any ways that you would describe your voice for writing?
That's a great question. I don't know if it could be described in words. I feel like it's something, you know, I think for every writer, you kind of have your own unique tone. I'm sure you can relate to this as a writer yourself, but it's just, you know, the way, like your style. And I think it's harder to express it in journalism when you're writing like reporting stories. I mean, you still can, but it's kind of more difficult to find. But with fictional stuff, I think it's just something that kind of comes to you, you know, like your inner voice.
Absolutely. Yeah. So what are some of the differences that you've encountered, like in writing for journalism and writing for fiction and writing for memoirs? It's most of the time people don't do all three.
I've always kind of loved fiction writing. I wrote a lot of short stories when I was younger. They're pretty messed up looking back for like a 9-year-old to be writing, but I wrote a lot of horror short stories. So I've always kind of liked writing fiction. But one thing I noticed with myself is if I was writing a news story, I like had to give myself a buffer between when I wrote a short story, like I would be writing a news story. And then if I wrote a short story right after, I'd find myself looking at it in this like objective lens where I'm like, I'm writing a short story. I shouldn't be doing this. I didn't as much run into that when I was writing the book, because by the time I was writing the book, I wasn't really doing the newspaper anymore. But when I was doing reporting and short in fiction writing at the same time, I had to keep kind of a separation, like a day apart.
Yeah. I can imagine that would be difficult to get into like the right mood to write such different things like that.
Yeah.
Were there any other like things that you did? Did you have any practices to kind of get yourself in the proper headspace for the various kinds of writing?
Yeah. I go on so many walks every day. It's like insane. If I don't have school, I'll go on like 9 or 10 walks a day, and they're all like 45 minutes.
Oh, wow.
And then when I'm writing, every 300 words, I have to go on a walk. I don't know what it is about walks, but it just, oh, another weird thing I do. There's a park in my town and there's a swing set. And I go on that swing set and it like clears my mind. I don't know what it is about it, but I look really crazy. but it works every time for me.
I find personally that a lot of, and like from the people that I've talked to on the show before, that the things that make us feel like we look crazy are usually the things that help us in the end.
That's usually how it works. My town of 800 people might not be ideal, but it works.
Yeah, absolutely. When you're writing, are there any things like, do you have any, like, I know some, I'm trying to think of how to word this properly, but I know some writers have like little rituals that they do. Like they always put on the same type of music, or they do certain things to keep like in the space for I am writing, I'm sitting down and I'm doing work. Do you have anything like that?
I used to kind of want to make, I did this with a lot of stuff. I had like a bunch of different flavors of gum, and I would chew a specific flavor of gum when I was doing a specific type of writing. I don't know if it helped me at all. I think it's just a weird thing I did. There's a period of time where I tried to listen to like classical music because I heard it would help me, but I couldn't. I can't do music because I start thinking of the music and I get all distracted and I'm making up all this stuff in my head. One thing I do, though, is I have insane amounts of caffeine. I have a lot of caffeine before I write. So I don't know. It's kind of changed over the years, but caffeine's been the constant.
Cool. Yeah. That's what I found talking to people a lot on the show, that over time, like the more you work and the more you write, it kind of shifts. Isn't always a defined thing.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
So, kind of pivoting a bit, but what are your reading habits like?
Oh my gosh, I read so much. I love reading. It's actually one of my favorite things. I used to read a lot when I was little. Even like before the newspaper, I read a lot. I've always kind of liked reading. Then I did the newspaper. I got a little distracted. You know, I wasn't reading as much. And then I started reading again a lot, like during quarantine. And then I kind of, when school started back up, I started reading even more because I had never realized this because I've been like homeschooled my entire life, basically. You have a lot of downtime in school, so you kind of need a book. I mean, some people were on their phones. So I'm not kind of right now because with all the book stuff, it's been kind of crazy, but I used to do like 2 books a week. Now I'm reading War and Peace. I really like that so far. I'm on chapter 7, but the thing about that book is I like to look and I like to see my progress, but that book's like almost 2,000 pages, so
I can imagine it would be a little disheartening looking through going, oh, I am 0.5%. So you mentioned earlier that you used to write a lot of like horror fiction and stuff. Do you find yourself reading that at all? Or do you have like a specific genre that you kind of gravitate towards?
I don't know why, but I love writing horror. And I was like that kid who was like, I love horror movies. Like I'm so mature for but I really, as I grew up, I realized I really didn't like horror movies. And I don't know why I kind of pretended I did. But I really don't like reading horror stuff. I mean, I read The Shining, and I really liked The Shining. Absolutely terrifying, but I liked it. But let me think. I think the books I gravitate towards, I don't know if it's a genre, but I gravitate towards a lot of books about like mentally ill women, I've noticed, because I find them very interesting. Yeah. But I read a lot of stuff.
That's really cool. Do you have a favorite book?
I was thinking about this question a lot. I don't think I can pick like an all-time favorite, but I think like this year, like books I've read, My Year of Rest and Relaxation, so good. And I know it's like a popular one. I think I'd sound cooler if I named something really obscure, but it's the truth. It's such a good book.
I have not read that one yet, but I've heard so many good things about it. It's for sure on my list.
Yeah.
So what inspired you to write this memoir, and like just like what gave you the idea at first to just sit down and start writing this? Do you remember that moment at all?
I think it was an exact moment, but it was something that kind of built up over time because, you know, since I was little, I was telling all these other people's stories and I loved it, but I realized how weird it was because other people started to tell my stories, which was a weird moment for me. And a lot of times in narrative, people were kind of spreading about me was not the full truth. It was painting me as this very, I don't know, like, you know, badass, like confrontational girl, like, I don't know. And it just really wasn't true to who I was. So I wanted to write a book to kind of set the narrative straight about my life.
That is so amazing. So inspiring.
Thank you. Thank you.
What was it like for you being that age and trying to deal with everyone kind of having an opinion?
Yeah, when I was younger and when it first started, I thought it was the coolest thing in the world. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm famous. No, but it was like, it was fun at first, but I realized, cause I never read any of the stuff that was written about me. I still don't, I can't watch back any of my interviews. It just makes me cringe. Like I'm not really into that stuff. But I wasn't really sure how people were painting me, but I kind of didn't really care to know because it's like, nobody's going to get me completely accurate anyway. But you know, you can kind of tell from like I started to be able to tell from the questions people would ask me with the context they would use, what kind of person they thought I was. And it was weird to be like, oh, that's not who I am at all. But when you're that young, you don't have like a clear idea of who you are at all. So it's, you know, I have all these people. I'm like, I didn't think that was who I was, but maybe that this is how I am and I just can't see it. So I kind of started playing into that narrative and I started to be the person that people thought I was just because I thought I was like that. And I didn't want to like disappoint people with who I actually was. I think going back to the horror movie thing, I think that kind of fits into that because I was thinking about this recently. I'm like, why did I say I liked horror movies? Cause it was like a personality trait of mine, but I think it's cause people like would meet me and they're like, oh, you probably like, you're so mature for your age. You probably love horror movies. You probably love all this stuff. I'm like, yeah, of course I do. But yeah. It wasn't like that.
I absolutely get that. It's like putting on, like agreeing to those expectations that are being put on you kind of.
Yeah, completely.
Well, I think it's so cool that you wrote this book and are doing all these things and kind of flipping over this narrative.
Thank you so much.
Do you have any tips for aspiring writers and journalists?
I think my number one thing that I tried to remember when I was reporting, especially, you know, being my age and woman and everything, is that if you take yourself seriously, other people will take you seriously too.
That is amazing advice. Actually, I would like to talk about what you just said, like how doing this and also being a woman, because that was something interesting that you bring up in your book every once in a while and how people viewed you being a young girl trying to do this and having this whole like successful thing and like how you were looked at differently. Could you speak on that a little bit?
Yeah. So I got this question a lot when I was younger, and my answer would be very different to what it was now. Because when I was younger, I was like, I don't think that was the case at all. I think it's just because of my age. But as I got older, I realized that that was not the case. I mean, of course, there's no way of really knowing for sure, but I definitely do think, unfortunately, my gender did play a role in the way people perceived me with my reporting. And I think I would have been a few steps ahead if I wasn't female, if that makes sense. But of course, I don't know. There's really no way of knowing because my age definitely was a big factor. But as I got older and I looked a lot older, I realized that I didn't face a lot of the issues I did when I was like little, but I faced kind of a new set of issues. You know, just the way people would talk to me, just completely different. I mean, I'm sure you understand. It's just, it's kind of off-putting.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And I can't even imagine working in something like journalism where, that already can have some sexism there and how that would work. Yeah.
Yeah.
So how did you go about finding pictures for your book and like choosing which pictures and stories and things to use?
Well, the pictures, I don't think they really came along until after I wrote it. Cause like, there were like certain parts, like when I was writing about like the early chapters and me being younger, I'm like, oh, I should use this picture when I'm selling lemonade. I should do this stuff. But as I got older, I was like, what pictures do I have for this? I have no idea. So in the early chapters, I had an idea, but for the final, like the final cut, I really just did it after the writing was over.
Cool. Yeah. I can imagine that it would be kind of hard to look at like your entire life and sort through it to decide on that. What was that like for this? It's something that I always ask people with memoirs. Like it's something that I find endlessly interesting.
It's extremely weird. It doesn't get any, like I had a TV show based on my life. Extremely weird, right? And there's not, I don't know, you think, I thought in my head, it's like, okay, the TV show, I had that. I've already gotten the weirdness out of the way. When I write this book, it won't be weird at all. But no, it doesn't get any less weird over time. It's really kind of surreal. But, you know, I'll be writing this and I'll be like, oh my gosh, that was a chapter of my life. And I'll get all sentimental. But it's definitely a surreal experience. I had to talk to a lot of people in my family just to make sure everything was accurate. Because my memories aren't always completely, you know, accurate to how a situation actually was.
Mm, of course. Yeah. I can imagine that it would be hard to remain objective with something like that.
Yeah. That's where I got a lot of help from my mom. I've had her look over all the stuff I wrote. And I'm like, did this actually happen? Or am I just kind of spinning out of control on this one?
I absolutely get that. Well, what sort of advice did she give you? And was there any like points where you were not too happy with said advice in the writing?
Oh yeah. My mom, a lot of people don't know this. People know my dad is a writer, but my mom's actually an amazing writer. The thing about her is she is a very harsh critic, which I think has helped my writing a lot. It's helped my writing a lot, but it definitely, and you know, I look back on some of the things, I'm like, oh yeah, she definitely needed to tell me that. That was definitely much needed. But at the time, you don't want to hear anything like that. You want to be like, oh, this is amazing. This is wonderful. You're a genius. But looking back, all of her advice was definitely for the best.
That's awesome. So when you were first starting your newspaper, Orange Street News, what sort of like things like that did you have like in place, any people helping you or anything like that? And kind of off of that, could you also share a bit how you got started with that for our audience?
So when I first had the idea that I wanted to start my newspaper, I had it handwritten on note cards. Like I'm so happy I have these here. I have these here because I write down, I just gave a keynote speech, and the way I memorize things is writing everything down, but that's not the point. So I would write my newspaper on papers, not joking, like this big, maybe even smaller, like the little cue card ones. And I would do it in like, I remember this red crayon I used because it's the sharpest out of all my crayons. And, but I realized quickly that wasn't going to get me very far because I sold those little newspapers to everybody in my house, except for a dime, and not one person bought it. No one in my family for a dime. But I realized soon that I wanted to, like do something really serious with it, and that wasn't going to get me anywhere. So I went to my dad and I asked my dad, if I could use his printer and if he could help me with layout to make it like an actual format. So I printed, so my first story was my little sister being born, and that was like the front page.
Nice. And then if you I think that's so cool to me. That seems like such a special like family thing that you have that now, like forever is your first story. I was reading that in your book. I was like, oh, that's so special to get to have that.
Yeah. It's so weird because my little sister, Juliet, that's, you know, like the baby who was born, right? I look at her and she's what? She's seven. Okay. And she's like, it's weird because she's like a full functioning person. Like she walks and she talks. And it's weird to look at her and be like, that's how old my newspaper is. She's so funny. She wrote me this note. She got really mad at me because, okay, so I have a door here. I have a bathroom and then I have my little sister's room. And then I have a door outside there. My little sister, Juliet, she will bang on my door. And by the time I get to the door, she's outside and she's banging on my window because oh, she wants me to let her in. And one time I was reading and I got so mad at her. I'm like, you're not going in my room. I'm not letting you in, because she's super hyper. So she wrote me this note she wrote me this like really dramatic note, and it was like, "I'm not your friend anymore," in all caps, and she slipped it under my door. That was so, I don't even know how I got to that story. But she's such a character. I don't know how I got to that story. I'm sorry, I'm getting so off track.
No, it's okay. It's okay. As I tell everyone on this show, I like when people kind of ramble and tell me things, because then people listening can get a better view of the author, right?
You definitely got an exclusive on that one.
Yes. Well, you know, that was actually all I had for you today, but thank you so much for coming on. This was
thank really you for great. Having me. This is so fun.
Yeah, I had a blast. I just have one last question, and that is, mm-hmm. what do you have coming up?
That's a good question. I've been wondering that myself. I have been exploring a lot of my interests that aren't writing, because I've been writing for a long time, even before I started the newspaper. That's always been kind of the thing I liked. Mm-hmm. I think I might want to be a filmmaker. I'm really into that. I think that would be a fun thing for me. But I also really like math, and I think I might want to be a biochemical engineer.
Oh, wow.
So they're very, very different things. But I'm exploring a lot of the interests I have, and that's what I'm trying to do in high school, trying to get that figured out. Cool.
Well, that is awesome. Thank you. Congratulations on
thank you so
your
much.
Memoir, and good luck with all of the future things, whether that be filmmaking or biochemical engineering or writing or anything. For Read Between the Lines, my name is Molly Southgate.
I'm Hilde Kate Lysiak.
Let's end this the way all great stories end. Happily ever after. The end.
Thank you for listening to Read Between the Lines, a book podcast. You can follow the show on Instagram and Facebook at Read Between the Lines Podcast and on Twitter at RBTL Podcast. Make sure to follow the authors who I've been talking to hear all about their upcoming projects, and also because they're cool people. This show is hosted by me, Molly Southgate, and produced and edited by my dad, Rob Southgate. Read Between the Lines is a Southgate Media Group production, and you can find all the great content put on by the network at southgatemediagroup.com. You can read the story of how I and many other podcasters started in the anthology book Pod Life, which you'll find at the link in the show notes. Also in the show notes are links to buy the books featured on this episode. Using those links supports this show and the incredible authors being interviewed. Have a great week and keep reading.